Google introduces Pathways, their next-generation AI architecture. OpenAI solves high school math problems. And Facebook goes all on first-person view. Welcome to ML News. But before the video starts, a quick thanks to our sponsor, Weights and Biases. I want to show you this one feature that I just learned about. Did you know you can embed a Weights and Biases report in Notion? It's actually not only reports, but also other stuff by Weights and Biases. So they have this neat little page here. Ironically, it is actually in Notion, and it is super easy to embed live Weights and Biases stuff into Notion. So for example, here I have a sweep, and you can see the sweep is in interactive, so you can do all the kinds of things you're used to analyzing a Weights and Biases sweep. Now I can just grab that URL, get over to Notion, and create a new embed, paste the link, and there we go. Look at that. This is a fully functional Weights and Biases report inside of Notion. So you have all the interactivity here that you would usually have, as you can see. So I can look at my runs, I can activate them, I can even go and look at my sweep controls and various things. This is really cool if you work together with other people and you work on more than just Weights and Biases reports. You can take your notes in Notion and then embed the report, the sweep, whatever, into Notion page. I love Notion, I love Weights and Biases, and it's very cool the two go together. If you don't know Weights and Biases, it is your one-stop shop for all your machine learning experimental needs, from trying out models, optimizing hyperparameters, all the way to saving your models, deploying them, and so on. It runs in the cloud, it's free for personal users and for education. There are plans for teams and for self-hosted setups, so all the more reason to go try it out. Thanks again to Weights and Biases for sponsoring this video, and now let's get into it. Bye bye. Hello and welcome to ML News. Let's dive into our first story. Jeff Dean has released a blog post on the Google blog. Note, this is not the Google AI blog. This is the main Google blog. He's also given a TED talk about the subject, and the subject is this model called Pathways, a next generation AI architecture. We don't actually know much about this architecture because all we have is that TED talk and this illustration right here. And essentially, Jeff Dean imagines Google's future AI projects to rely on this new architecture, where instead of having single task neural networks that you train, you have this giant multitask neural network that can do all the tasks at once, and that would also be sparsely activated. As you can see here, different tasks would leverage different paths through this network. This goes along with a few criticisms on today's architectures. So he says, for example, today's AI models are typically trained to do only one thing. Pathways will enable us to train a single model to do thousands or millions of things. So the goal is to have one model do many, many tasks at once. Second, he says, today's models mostly focus on one sense. Pathways will enable multiple senses. This refers to the fact that the input to current neural networks are single modalities. Sometimes there are two modalities, but mostly they're single modalities like images or text or sound. This pathway architecture, naturally being multitask, will also be multimodal, which means that it could input any sort of modality. In his TED talk, he gives the example, whether or not you see a leopard or hear the word leopard or hear someone say the word leopard or see a video of a leopard, that should essentially evoke the same concept in your brain and therefore also in the pathway model. And lastly, he says, today's models are dense and inefficient. Pathways will make them sparse and efficient. This refers to the fact that our current networks are densely activated. Everything's connected to everything. And that's very, very inefficient. He imagines this future pathways architecture to be sparsely activated, meaning that only very small subparts of the network will be activated for a given input sample. And therefore, the different parts of the network doing different things, they don't always have to be active at the same time. This can also make the model much more efficient in terms of parameters and computation. Now, as I said, there's not a paper to go along with this or an implementation or even a plan of how to get there. This is essentially a wish list, and it's not a particularly new wish list. Like, people have dreamed of, oh, can't we just make multimodal, multitask models where one model learns everything? Well, yeah, everyone wishes that, but you still have the problems. Namely, for example, catastrophic forgetting. If you try to teach the model many tasks and then one task more, you still have to ensure that it doesn't forget the old tasks, which is very, very difficult, especially in this picture. It seems like this is a rather feed-forward architecture right here, without any sort of memory modules or anything like this. So how they're going to achieve that, I don't know. Secondly, they say there are many different tasks here. However, huge data architectures mostly rely on self-supervision and then fine-tuning for individual tasks and not having different tasks in parallel, though multitask training is a thing. And lastly, the sparse activations are not trivial to achieve. Again, people have been saying this forever, like, well, can't we just have a sparse neural network? Probably the brain is sparse, blah, blah, blah. But how are you gonna get there? This is just a wish list. How we're gonna get there? I don't know. The main problem with sparsity being that if you have a sparse forward signal, then your backwards gradients are also going to be sparse. You may never learn the correct sparse way through your network if you only activate sparsely in the forward pass. These are all challenges that have existed forever, but it seems like Google is determined to solve these challenges. I mean, if they can, all the better. But for now, it's just a plan and an idea, and I'm excited to see what happens. OpenAI has released a blog post called Solving Math Word Problems, where they train a language model to solve math problems. This goes along with a paper saying training verifiers to solve math word problems by people at OpenAI. You can read it if you want. Essentially, it is a data set of about 8,000 of these high school math problems, where you mainly need the basic addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division in order to solve the problem. They're usually stated as little stories, and they have some sort of an answer. Now, large language models such as GPT-3 are usually kind of bad at this type of stuff, mainly because they are not accurate enough, they don't do these simple steps that are required enough. They're more like a language model, they're more like a conversation model or a thing that simply repeats some of the stuff it has already seen. So the first approach the paper takes is to fine-tune such a language model on these tasks, and it turns out that doesn't go too well. Very often that makes a lot of mistakes as well, and the solution comes in the form of what they call verifiers. So verifiers are models that are not trained to produce the solution, but they are trained to rate whether a solution to a problem is likely to be the correct solution or not. So now what they do is they use one model that they fine-tuned to produce like 100 solutions, and then they use the verifiers to rank the solution and pick the best one. And that turns out to be very, very powerful. So we've seen approaches like this before. You remember the DALL-E model of OpenAI also not only used a generative model for the avocado chair, but it also used the CLIP model in order to rank the outputs of the generative model. So this could be a more general recipe for improving generative models, is train verifiers and then generate a bunch of solutions and rank them with the verifiers. As I said, you can read the paper, and the dataset of these math questions is available to download. Sam Altman tweeted, "Neural networks really, truly learn. It's not a fancy trick. This is one of the most remarkable things humans have ever figured out, and the implications are difficult to overstate." Now, I'm not sure if he just wanted to start like a fire with this kind of things. There are many ways of going about this, but it seems like the truth or veracity of the statement entirely depends on how you define learning. But it seems like Sam Altman, and in general, that's what we see out of OpenAI, is of the opinion that the learning that humans do isn't that much different from the learning that current large-scale neural networks inherently do. Now, this is to be set a little bit into contrast with what people from the more symbolicist camp may think about these neural networks and about the nature of learning and intelligence in general. But again, I guess it only depends on the definition of words here. And just putting the modifiers really and truly in front of a non-defined word doesn't suddenly make it defined. But what do you think? Let me know in the comments after you hit the subscribe button. See what I did there? Next news. Business Insider writes, Google's AI researchers say their output is being slowed by lawyers after a string of high-level exits. Getting published really is a nightmare right now. So the article starts off with a bunch of Google controversies. Obviously, some famous people were fired from Google recently, and there were a bunch of scandals around that. And now one senior AI researcher who spoke with Insider on the condition of anonymity comes forward and says, well, the lawyers are essentially up our necks right now. It's so difficult to publish. This is really stifling publishing inside of Google and so on. And the article backs this up by saying, according to Google's online records, the company published 925 pieces of AI research in 2019 and 962 in 2020. But the company looks to have experienced a moderate slowdown this year, publishing just 618 research papers in 2021 thus far. Now, this is the only thing where they actually back anything up that they say. Now, I've no doubt that this is the case inside of these big companies. They give examples whenever they write words such as bias or fairness, then the lawyers, they would just have like tons of questions or want to cross them out because they just don't understand the technical terms behind these things. Now, noteworthy terms like bias and fairness actually have about 60 technical definitions and they're all in conflict with each other, so can't exactly fault the lawyers. What I found funny is that in the last section here, a spokesperson from Google took a statement and said, we're publishing papers at the same rate we did last year. At this time, last year, there were 815 approved papers, and this year, there are 820 so far. The spokesperson said, adding, our website doesn't reflect all papers and is typically updated a few months after publications. So, they had to bury this on the very bottom of the article right here because they want to like tell a story about how lawyers are so terrible and about how this exit stifled Google so much. And don't get me wrong, lawyers are terrible and I'm pretty sure that they're a pain in the neck. But the claim that this is especially ramped up now doesn't seem to hold apart from like one or two anonymous people inside of Google coming forward. And the fact that they have to hide this thing at the very bottom, which is pretty clear, like that's a much more likely explanation than Google now suddenly ramping up their eyeballs of the lawyers. Like lawyers have always been like this. So Insider, I'm calling crap on you. DeepMind releases their Reinforcement Learning Lecture Series 2021. This is a lecture series about Introduction to Reinforcement Learning by DeepMind researchers at the University College London, and you can, in fact, watch all of them. They're freely available on YouTube, the slides are available, and it's pretty cool if you want to get into reinforcement learning. It starts out with the simple frameworks, and it ends with deep reinforcement learning. David Ha tweeted the following out, a pop-up shop in Shibuya will sell clothing with adversarial patches printed on them to make a fashion statement. Now, while I can't understand this exactly, I do think it's pretty cool. So the label or the brand or the store is called Camouflage Against the Machines, unlabeled, and the clothing features adversarial patches. Now, whether that will help in any way or form, like, I'm quite doubtful, but it is a pretty cool inside joke if you meet other researchers. The next one isn't really machine learning news, but it is quite important. A contributor to PyTorch has released a viable solution for Python concurrency. So if you don't know, CPython, the reference implementation for the Python language, has this problem that in a multi-threaded application, in order to keep track of all the objects flying around, it essentially is forced to do this reference counting. And in order to do proper reference counting, it essentially means that every time a reference is increased, incremented or decremented, it has to lock down all the threads. This is known as the GIL, the Global Interpreter Lock, and it is the reason why you can program multi-threaded applications in Python, but they will never be able to use the interpreter at the same time, which means that if you have CPU-bound applications, multi-threading will just not help. It will not speed up your application at all. You need to go to multi-processing. So the rule for the longest time has been, if your application is IO-bound, then you can use multi-threading. threading because it's easier to program, it's easier to reason about, you have shared state and so on. However, if your application is CPU bound, then you have to go to multiprocessing, which is quite a bit more heavy, more error prone, and so on. Many attempts have been made previously to remove the GIL, but every single actual implementation of a Python without a GIL had the advantage of being able to run multi-threaded applications really concurrently, but also the disadvantage that single-threaded applications, which most Python programs are single-threaded applications, would slow down due to these changes. But now this new suggestion by Sam Gross, who, as I already said, is a major contributor to PyTorch, is actually a viable solution and is being evaluated currently, which is pretty cool. And it may be that in the future, Python concurrent programming will get a lot easier. Big Science has released T0++, which is a model that is a multitask trained text-to-text model. Don't even exactly know how I should call this, but essentially they took T5 and they trained it with a bunch of different NLP tasks that you all frame as a really a text input. So if you don't know what T5 is, T5 is this concept that when I have an NLP task, rather than encoding it somehow in a smart way, I simply encode it as a natural language prompt. For example, if I want to translate from French to English, I simply say, please translate the following from French to English, and then I put the French sentence, and then I train the model to autoregressively predict the English sentence. This means I can use pre-trained language models as a start for these models, and namely that is what GPT-3 does zero shot out of the box. So the idea here is that if GPT-3 can do this in a zero shot fashion, these natural language tasks that are formulated in the language of, let's say, of the input of English, can't we achieve the same or better zero shot performance if we don't pre-train the model on language modeling as GPT-3 is, but if we instead pre-train the model on other tasks? So T0 is this model that takes a bunch of different NLP tasks, puts them all into the language as a human would input them or type them up, so they're compatible with a language model, trains all of them at the same time, and it turns out that the resulting model can actually do new NLP tasks in a zero-shot fashion, much like GPT-3, but is way more parameter efficient at that. So this is pretty cool, and the model is available on Hugging Face. So here you see a bunch of examples of what that can look like. They have different versions of this model. You can import it in the Hugging Face API. You can even try it out here on the website. And the thing I want to highlight is that Big Science isn't some research lab or a company. It's actually a one-year-long research workshop on large multilingual models and datasets. This is simply a conglomeration of a bunch of researchers from all over the world that is loosely organized together for 1 year to investigate these large models. So it's pretty cool that something outside of traditional academia or corporate research labs also comes into the game and provides lots of cool stuff for the AI community. Definitely check it out, check out their paper, check out their models. Speaking of the Hugging Face Hub, Hugging Face released this tweet saying that the dataset viewer is available in Hugging Face Hub. This is essentially a preview where you can, for any dataset, go and see what kind of samples are in there. Not for any dataset, but for any that supports the Hugging Face streaming API, which are like half the datasets on the Hugging Face Hub. This works for images. So here you can see MNIST, and you already saw some NLP things. So pretty cool. Hugging Face Hub is getting more and more useful by the day. Site is a sort of a Google Scholar-ish type of thing where you can look for publications, and then inside the publications, every citation will be annotated, first of all, with the context of where it goes. So any citation target, if you click on it, you'll see sort of the context of the citation. And second of all, it is annotated with the fact of whether the citation actually supports the cited research or is critical of it or refutes it. So you have positive and negative citations. And this gives you a much more accurate picture of how a particular paper has fared in the research landscape, in how it was cited, and not only whether it was cited. This is done in part by an automated system, and I believe they already have a giant amount of research articles in there and automating these extraction of references, and they are scoring them using deep learning model. What else? There is a paper to go along with it. Check check it out if you like and give Sight a try. It isn't exactly free. There are different tiers right here with different features, but if this is at all helpful to you, I guess it might be worth it. Facebook AI releases a blog post called Teaching AI to Perceive the World Through Your Eyes. This is a push by Facebook or Meta or whatever it is called right now to go away from the standard data sets where you have some third person view of a scene to really first person data sets. So they have a bunch of collections of data from around the world, from different people in different life circumstances in many, many places. And they collected first-person data, meaning I guess these people had head-mounted cameras and had other sensors on, and they recorded just doing everyday activities. So the dataset is called Ego 4D, and what I think is cool about it is the dataset generation process is different from what other datasets are. Not only the fact that it is first-person and that it is, you know, distributed all over the world and not just done by a single person or team, but also because they just told the people, you know, just record yourself doing everyday stuff. And then after the fact, they went ahead and they defined tasks and they annotated the data for labels. So they didn't have the labels in mind when they collected the data, or maybe they had them in mind, but they didn't collect the data specifically to get some labels. First collected the data and then they put different labels over top. So for example, different tasks that they imagine are memory tasks, forecasting tasks, object recognition, whatnot. They have various layers of labels annotated by humans, by crowd workers on this data. And the data set, you know, you can imagine that these aren't the only labels. It's fine. In fact, it is very feasible that a different research group goes ahead and annotates the data in a different way to create their own task. The blog post highlights the difficulty of ego-centric data, which is usually vastly different from like a third-person view. As you can see here on the left, this object detector works quite well in a third person view. However, in a first person view, it just kind of fails. So is this a good way forward to build more capable systems or a step into dystopia? I guess that's up to you. But if you like working with data like this, then give this dataset a try. I'm not exactly sure how you can get a hold of it. I think there is some sort of license attached, but yeah, it's out there. Tesla released, apparently pretty randomly, a guide to a configurable floating point format and arithmetic. So this is a very technical specification for 8-bit and 16-bit floating point numbers and arithmetic, and is supposed to sort of standardize or give a format to configurable floating point numbers. So as I said, it's very technical. It's actually also quite short. And the gist here is that they say if you train AI models on really large scale, like Tesla does, you might want to go down from 32-bit numbers to 16-bit numbers or even 8-bit numbers. However, in these very low regimes, you only have whatever 8-bit to play with, and therefore you can't exactly specify ahead of time how many bits should be the exponent and how many bits the mantissa should be. Therefore, this needs to be configurable. So not like in a 32-bit number, you have exactly this many bits for this and this many bits for that. In these new configurable floating point numbers, this would be a variable that you can decide as you use the number. So that allows you to trade off what kind of range this number can potentially have with the accuracy, the resolution that the number can have in a particular range. We'll see whether this remains a thing that's purely used inside of Tesla or whether other people are going to adopt it. Microsoft introduces PyTorch Direct ML. They say train your machine learning models on any GPU. So this is a component for PyTorch that allows you to use any DirectX GPU for doing deep learning. And all that is necessary essentially is that in PyTorch, you don't say to CUDA, like if you have a CUDA device, now you say to DML, to Direct ML. And that's it. This works on Windows and on the Windows subsystem for Linux. So if you're still a Windows user for whatever reason, good for you. All right, more helpful things that I saw this week. There are a lot of helpful things this week. It's not only helpful libraries, it's the section is renamed to just help. Like, help me, please. PyWIC is a high-level, batteries-included neural network training library for PyTorch. And yes, whatever you're thinking is said here at the beginning of the README. Does the world need another PyTorch framework? Probably not, but we started this project when no good frameworks were available, and it just kept growing, so here we are. Yeah, respect. Cool. If none of the current frameworks please you, PyWIC might be for you. Lexa is a benchmark for zero-shot reaching of goals. This goes along with a paper by CMU, UPenn, and U of T about reaching goals after discovering the world. So these agents, what they'll do is they'll essentially go ahead and they'll just try out a bunch of stuff in the world without any explicit goals. And after that, you give the models a picture of a goal to reach, and they're supposed to reach it. So this means you don't explicitly train the agents to reach that particular goal or any goal. You simply let them explore, and after that they have to reach a goal. So Lexa is a benchmark that achieves this, and as I said, this goes along with the paper that gives a very, very, very good baseline for this benchmark already. But the benchmark itself is available to download if you're interested in doing that kind of research. Give it a try. Next, Danijar Hafner tweets out, excited to introduce Crafter. So this is a game, sort of an open world game, long-term reasoning, exploration, generalization, made for reward agents and unsupervised agents. So it's called Crafter, and you move around and there's blocks and there's food and you have to dig and you have to build and you have to craft things. I've never seen anything like this before. This is a first. This has no relation to any game that I've seen so far. No, it's pretty cool. So you can craft things, as you can see right here. You can interact with stuff. Every world is randomly generated. Like, this is a Minecraft clone, but amenable to machine learning research, to AI research. So that is pretty cool, because Minecraft just seems too complex because you can move like in any direction and so on. Here it's really discrete. So these models, they have a much more easy time to go about it. They've already evaluated different of these AI learning mechanisms on it, like Dreamer, PPO, Rainbow Agents, and so on. And none of them really compare so far to Human Expert. But I think the game's pretty cool. It is available. These RL agents can already do things like, you know, dig holes, build bridges, and so on. There's very complex behaviors already emerging. Here it moves out of the way of a skeleton, and in another one, it builds a shelter. Excellent. Crafter, give it a try. If this video gets more than 3 likes, we'll do a Crafter Let's Play. For sure. Robert Lange releases a lightweight hyperparameter optimization tool. This seems to be a cool kind of personal project by Robert, and he released it with pretty good documentation. There's Colab, there is an example, and if you're just looking for like a very simple way to do hyperparameter optimization, then this might be the library for you. As you can see, there's different strategies for doing hyperparameter optimization and different ways you can define them. That's pretty much all you need. It even has the fancy decorator style, as you can see right here. Very Pythonic. Sayak Paul released a Keras tutorial on MobileVit. So this is a tutorial that will guide you through implementing mobile visual transformers in Keras, which is quite neat. So Keras, still as easy to use as ever. And this tutorial guides you through building the architecture from the ground up all the way to training it. At the end, you convert this model to TF-Lite so it actually runs on your mobile phone. Pretty cool. Omar Sanseviero tweets out, this demo is surprising. It combines VIT with GPT-2 to caption images with great results. And yes, actually, I was positively surprised. This is a Hugging Face module where you take a existing text model like GPT-2 and you take an existing image computer vision model like Vision Transformer and you combine them. So first you start out with sort of random cross attention weights that you fine tune just a little bit. And that can have really good results. Essentially, the model learns how to connect the latent representation from one model to the other model and back. So this is used right here to do an image captioning demo using GPT-2 and VIT, as I said, and training only about 7,000 steps on the COCO dataset. So here you can see the result. This is a man swinging a tennis racket on a tennis court. That is very descriptive. that is just an unhumanly precise description of what's going on right here. Here you have a blue and white street sign sitting on top of a pole. Yes, that is also a very, very, very precise description. Person riding a skateboard on top of a cement floor. Well, I guess that has some importance. Is it just me or AI models just bureaucrats? But yeah, pretty cool. Bits and Bytes is a library by Facebook Research for 8-bit optimizers and quantization routines. So they have a bunch of optimizers such as Atom, AtomW, RMSProp, and so on that work on 8 bits instead of 32, and that pretty reliably saves you 75% of the memory. Something like Atom has 2 or 3 different buffers that for every parameter you need to keep track of, so this can pretty quickly get pretty large, and saving 3/4 of the memory has definitely value. Now, I love that it's called Facebook Research, but if you hover, it says Meta Research. Is this gonna go well? I don't know. Also, is this supposed to be like a pretzel? Like, is it supposed to be like a flat logo? Or is it supposed to represent sort of like a Pringles chips? You know, like the saddle in 3D? I don't know. Another helpful thing, user-friendly introduction to pack-based bounce by Pierre Alquier. Now, this is something I have no clue about, but I know it's important, and I have learned it at some point. If you're trying to get into pack-based bounce, this is I believe, over 60 pages introduction to it that seems to be quite well written, introducing you to all the important concepts in it. So if you're interested, give it a try. Again, Face Meta whatever research releases XFormers, hackable and optimized transformers building blocks supporting a composable construction. So if you're into transformers and if you would like to recombine them, try out different things inside of them, XFormers might be a great library on doing that. So you see all of these boxes here. Essentially, this library makes it pretty easy to just rearrange them, connect them differently, and so on. Superb is a speech processing universal performance benchmark. This means that this benchmark has a bunch of speech tasks, so tasks in machine learning where the input is a piece of speech, but the goal here is that you have one pipeline that generates a representation, and then that representation can be fine-tuned easily to all of these tasks. So you're not supposed to solve all of the tasks from scratch. You're supposed to come up with that pipeline that generates the representation. If you work on speech, this might be very cool for you. K-k-k-ka. I don't know how to say this. K-k-k-ka. CCQA is a web-scale question answering dataset for model pre-training. This is a large-scale QA dataset that I guess you can use for pre-training question answering models. Excellent. Bagua is a library that claims to speed up PyTorch. So they have a bunch of things in here for PyTorch. For example, advanced distributed training algorithms, performance auto-tuning, generic fused optimizers, load-balanced data loader, and so on. So these seem to be specialized algorithms that in very certain cases where you want to use PyTorch can potentially deliver a lot of speed up. So if your problem doesn't fall into like the standard bucket what the library is optimized for, maybe you can find something inside of Bagua that is gonna help you. Bagua? Bagua? I don't know. Treex is a PyTree module system for deep learning in JAX. So if you work with PyTree, this is it in JAX. Good job. PyTree, for those of you who don't know, are essentially trees out of Python structures. So here, for example, a list which contains numbers and dicts, which themselves contain tuples and so on. So a PyTree works with these kinds of objects, and now you can use them inside of JAX. And Treex helps you to do that in a more module-oriented way, or a more object-oriented way. Reuters writes, AI can see through you, CEO's language under machine microscope. This article essentially says that things like NLP and speech sound analysis, they now go after CEO's quarterly announcements, they analyze their voices, and they're trying to just recognize when they're nervous and so on. And they actually have a point in that they claim they can make better investment decisions if they do something like this. But as you know, as soon as you pay attention to anything like this, these CEOs are immediately going to adjust and train to trick essentially these AI systems. So they will use scripted speeches much more in order to not trip the NLP systems. They will train their voice acting more, I guess, or let some press secretary speak for them. All in all, it just seems to be like, you know, if you analyze a CEO's speech and to detect when they're lying and when not, and then make investment decisions, you'll simply reinforce the the like the sociopaths that have no problem with just straight out lying, that have no difference in their voice whatsoever. So if you want to create a world of more sociopathic CEOs than it already is, I guess, then go right ahead. Just do this. This is fine. Excellent. Cadbury, the company, has apparently made this ad for Indian local businesses. And it's not just an ad, but they've paid this Indian celebrity to record essentially one ad, and then they modified that ad using deep learning. So they have like three product categories, like shoes and I guess glasses and watches or something like this. They've recorded the different ads for the different products, but whenever the actor says the company name and the location of the company, they use deep learning to change whatever the small business is. So essentially, this is a deepfake from the same actor to his own face, but to make him say something else. So as a small business in India, you can go there and get your ad for your local business. The system will actually make sure that people that are in your area are advertised with your particular business, and people in different areas will see, I guess, the same ad, but the actor mentioning a different business that is in that area. Pretty cool. There's a form. If you're in India, you know, check it out. And lastly, this shoe does not exist. This is a website. I guess it's analogous to This Person Does Not Exist, which was a famous website that trained StyleGAN 2 on a face dataset. So this is StyleGAN 3, which was recently released, the alias-free GAN, and it's trained on a shoe dataset. So you can just refresh and look at shoes that the model has come up with. I guess these shoes all look like they exist. They might as well. Who knows? But yeah, if you're looking for unique design ideas, check it out. I'm looking forward to many more things where StyleGAN 3 is applied. It seems to be the quality of these models and the ease of training them has come a long way, such that it is in fact possible to do this for many types of things where you have decently amounts of data, such as shoes, I guess. All right, this was it for this week's ML News. Thank you so much for being here. Don't forget to like and subscribe and let me know what you think in the comments. I value your opinions, definitely. This is not just a trick to get the YouTube algorithm to promote the video more and all of that kind of stuff. See ya.